Welcome, everyone. I am Michael Fromm, Chair of the Jewish Council for Public Affairs. On behalf of our board, I'd like to welcome you all to JCPA's Delegates Assembly educational meeting. We appreciate that each of you took the time to attend today's Zoom, to join with your peers in our national network to deal with pressing issues, to learn, and most importantly, to strategize. The work of the Community Relations Network, building consensus, developing trusted relationships with partners and affiliates, and advocating for a just and pluralistic America and support for Israel is as crucial today as it was when the organization was established in the 1940s. As the convener of this network, JCPA is here to support all of you who are carrying out this critical work throughout the country and to help ensure that you as leaders in your own communities are well-informed and have the tools you need. This is an education session. We will not be voting today. You can find the meeting agenda in the chat. All bios for the speakers in today's session have been previously sent to you and will also be linked in the chat box. You may have noticed that the Biden administration has established issue-focused themes for each day. We're especially pleased to note that the topic of our own delegates assembly meeting, racial justice, nicely aligns with today's White House theme of equity. During the meeting, we ask that everyone follow these best practices for a virtual session. Keep yourself on mute, except when you are actively speaking. Set your screen for speaker view, which will enable you to see the presenters as a panel. Feel free to use the chat box to share your thoughts or interact with one another. This Zoom meeting is a safe space in which each person's viewpoint is respected. Feel free to ask clarifying questions of each other. If you have any questions, please send a message privately to Haya Lufting. During the breakout groups, you will have time to address issues with a smaller group of other call participants and to pose questions to the group and the facilitator. Please display your first and last name in your Zoom box, along with that of your organization and location if appropriate. You can adjust this by right-clicking on the name currently listed and changing it. Tomorrow is International Holocaust Remembrance Day. At JCPA's 2019 annual conference, we passed a Holocaust education resolution. And the timing of today's meeting helps us to underscore this important work. We're especially honored to have Alicia Wiesel with us to start off today's session. Alicia is the son of Nobel laureate Elie Wiesel. Alicia himself is a thought leader on Holocaust remembrance and what it means in today's world. I'm fortunate to consider Alicia a friend. On a personal note, I'd like to thank Alicia for making the time to be with us today, despite the fact that he's throwing a huge 90th birthday party for his mom, Marion, tomorrow night, via Zoom, of course. And he's invited all of us to attend to hear her incredible life story. The details will appear in the chat box. Alicia, thanks for being with us.
Thank you so much, Michael. It's not an easy thing to serve the Jewish community. It never has been. Are you afraid for our people? Are you afraid for our country? If you are, I understand the fear. Anti-Semitism was on a steep rise even before COVID. We saw shooting attacks at synagogues and kosher markets in Pittsburgh, Poway, and Jersey City. These attacks were seeded by the poisonous teachings of David Duke that we, American Jewry, were handing white America over to minorities. And they were also, these attacks, seeded by the contradictory and just as poisonous teachings of Louis Farrakhan that we, American Jewry, were colonializing and oppressing minorities. 2020 arrived with a fear of disease, of its direct effects, and what it would do to our families and our jobs. And we also felt the fear that we would not be up to the task of uprooting racial injustice wherever we find it, without either leaving the task woefully incomplete or with our cities burned. Some Jews were terrified seeing the Capitol attacked by men wearing shirts saying 6 million wasn't enough or Camp Auschwitz. I certainly felt fear as an American, fear for our democracy. Other Jews felt that while disgusting and vile, the idiots wearing those shirts were not the threat, that it's easy to see our enemies coming when they're wearing a swastika. But it's not so easy when they are college professors or college administrations or campus student leaders presenting themselves as fair and civilized while they demonize Israel as the state most worthy of scorn and protest in the modern world. I am afraid too. Do you feel anger? Do any of you either ever feel anger to your fellow Jew or to your fellow American? I'm furious that over the past 4 years, I've been screamed at by Jews telling me that I'm a traitor for criticizing the president's policies on immigration and his words that encourage xenophobia. I've also been screamed at by Jews telling me that I'm a racist because I refuse to say that every single thing the Trump administration ever did is poisoned, even when I think there are some ways in which the administration showed admirable bravery in keeping decades-old promises to Israel and shattering lies about the possibility of peace. If I try, I can get myself furious at each of you who disagree with me. But of course, I don't need to try. Facebook's algorithms will encourage me just fine down this road of seeing a world of black and white, of hearing what I either want to hear or what will infuriate me. Politicians who realize that moderates are easy pickings for a primary contest from extremist firebrands will get onto tickets and into powers, and the angriest among us will vote in those primary contests, not necessarily those of us who take time for the deeper breath. Our national divide and our divide as a Jewish community seems almost insurmountable. Do you ever feel despair? Perhaps you have felt at times that there is no point in an environment like this, and sometimes stepping down can be the right move. My father thought about resigning as chairman of the United States Holocaust Museum while it was still being formed, when he had heard that President Carter felt there were too many Jews on the board. He ultimately did resign shortly after President Reagan and his staff doubled down on Bitburg, justifying the trip after it happened by saying the SS were victims too. I would argue that the United States correctly resigned from the United Nations Human Rights Council when it proved itself to be run by the biggest human rights abusers on the planet, spending its time praising countries who did not deserve it, spending all of its energy criticizing Israel. I felt a spark of anger there from those of you who disagree with me. God bless you for your ideals and for believing that the U.S. should rejoin UNHRC. But we do not have this choice. How can one resign from the Jewish community? We know what that looks like. Too many already are. If you believe the Pew Report, those of us who are non-Orthodox are assimilating ourselves into oblivion. How can one resign from the American people? We know what that looks like too. Tens of thousands of National Guardsmen needed this month to assure the peaceful transfer of power in the world's most established democracy. No, we cannot quit. You cannot quit. Your service may be the glue that keeps us together for this coming stretch of time. I would ask you, make us as a Jewish community feel heard in our fears. The fear of Camp Auschwitz shirts and jackboots does not negate a fear of the anti-Semitic college professor in Tweed. You have room to hear all of our fears. Show us that we can discuss important issues without anger. Make space for those who contribute to Am Yisrael by standing up for a strong and secure Israel. Make space for those who contribute to Am Yisrael by standing up for Jewish values in this country. And make space for those who want to make us a better Am Yisrael by provoking and challenging us on Israeli policies, whether on settlements or otherwise. Help us all listen to and appreciate each other. And lastly, give us hope that we will attain, if not unity of opinion, then unity of purpose, unity of conduct, and unity of respect for each other. That's my bracha for you as you continue your important work. Thank you for letting me speak to you today, Michael.
Alicia, thank you for your thoughtful and important remarks. We were so lucky to have you here with us today, and your remarks provide a wonderful framework for the rest of today's meeting. For those of you who don't know me, I'm David Bohm. I'm the chair of JCPA's Policy Advisory Committee and the Delegates Assembly. Today we'll be addressing two important issues. First, we'll be hearing from those who are working on the plight of the Uyghurs. The more we learn about that situation, the more concerned we become about the human rights atrocities taking place there. We've received numerous inquiries asking what you can do on this issue, and there is a resolution that is heading to our annual conference addressing this topic. The second issue that we will focus on today is achieving racial justice, a concern that is front and center in our current work. To help us to move from concept to advocacy, we've invited speakers from partner civil rights organizations to share with us their policy priorities for the 117th Congress and the new administration. JCPA is developing a racial justice platform that will help us align with these agencies' priorities, enable us to partner on those issues in order to lessen racial disparities in our country. After the presentation, we will discuss this further in smaller breakout groups. Let's begin. I will now turn the meeting over to Amber Mays from the Jewish Community Relations Council of Indianapolis, who will introduce this portion of our meeting.
Hello, everyone. First and foremost, I want to thank you all for taking time away from your busy schedules to join us and become witnesses to these important conversations. So why are we here today? Why are we discussing the Uyghur? What is the ongoing issue? So since the late 1980s, the Chinese government has engaged in an oppressive campaign against the Uyghurs. The Uyghurs are a Muslim minority, ethnic minority that primarily reside in East Turkestan, which has been renamed the Xinjiang Uyghur Autonomous Region by the Chinese government. As part of a crackdown in early 2017, the Chinese government constructed a vast network of detention centers, forced labor camps throughout the region that now intern millions of people and have established a sophisticated surveillance system to ensure the remaining Uyghur population comply with a vast array of restrictions. The Chinese government claims these camps are vocational training centers, that they are aimed at re-educating the Uyghur population. However, testimonies from survivors as well as leaked Chinese government documents paint a vastly different picture. So what we know is that the Chinese government has and continues to engage in arbitrarily detaining and disappearing Uyghur intellectuals, using the population for organ harvesting and forced labor, sanctioning the rape of Uyghur women, forcing the Uyghur population to assimilate in an attempt to eradicate their ethnic identity, and carrying out physical torture to and extrajudicial killings of Uyghurs, as well as other crimes against humanity. Those who have yet to be interned in the camps are subject to 24-hour surveillance. They are required to attend political meetings, take part in written and spoken Mandarin language classes, face harsh religious observance restrictions, including such as forced burning of prayer rugs and consumption of non-halal food. Uyghurs have been forced to surrender their passports and must receive special permission from local officials to leave their home villages, which severely limits their freedom, their right to freedom of movement. Further complicating this issue is actually the deep entrenchment of our global supply chains within the region. Many of our products actually contain forced labor, Uyghur forced labor. Xinjiang is a major source of textiles, hair products, thread, yarn, tomato products, and 20% of the world's cotton from this region. The United States has taken some moderate measures to prevent these products from ending up on American shelves, but there's much more that needs to be done. The strongest statement condemning the atrocities came earlier this month when the U.S. government determined that the Chinese government is engaging in gross human rights violations that constitute genocide. So I would like to now introduce our panelists so they can provide more insight into the ongoing genocide. I'd like to welcome Serena Oberstein and Rehana Saad. Serena is the executive director of Jewish World Watch. And Rehan is the president of the American Turkic International Lawyers Association and is a Uyghur advocate. So welcome. Thank you both for being here today and for sharing your insights on what is happening to the Uyghurs in China. So first, Serena, I would like to ask, what compelled Jewish World Watch to engage on this issue with everything else facing the Jewish community? Why should we prioritize this?
Thanks, Amber. And thanks so much for inviting me, JCPA, to address this body and begin this extremely urgent conversation. Rooted in our own experiences of Jewish persecution, values, and traditions, Jewish World Watch was founded in 2004 when the silence about the genocide in Darfur was deafening. More than 75 years after the Holocaust and 17 years after our founding, genocide and mass atrocity are still rampant. And we as a community are obligated to ensure that never again isn't just an empty phrase, but a call to action. Unfortunately, the horror stories we've heard about Uyghur people, as you talked about, Amber, being taken in the night, having their heads shaved, being put on trains, interned in concentration camps, forced into slave labor, and systematically murdered are all too familiar to our community. And being silent isn't an option for us. We have to hold the Chinese government accountable, and the US and Jewish community must be a moral compass for the rest of the world. We as Jews can point to moments in our modern history, like the pogroms and the Holocaust, which make us experts on the signs of genocide and mass atrocity, as well as the consequences of what happens when the world stands silent. Or we can look to our traditions and holidays for guidance. Pesach reminds us that we were once strangers in a strange land, and also that we were liberated not by Pharaoh, but by God. And because of that, we are obligated to fight for the liberation of others. By tying together the stories of the Jewish and Uyghur people through our unique histories of persecution, but also our rich and deep cultures, we can amplify the voices of Uyghurs and address the human rights atrocities being perpetrated against them, now formally determined a genocide, by compelling the global community to take action in coordination and maximize our efforts.
Thank you, Serena. So I suppose another question for you would be, what specifically makes this a genocide? I think that there's kind of this misnomer that for there to be genocide, there has to be thousands, millions of people being killed, but that's not quite the case. Can you provide just a little bit of context for that?
Sure, absolutely. You know, initially when Jewish World Watch got involved, we started talking about it as a cultural genocide, right? We saw people being targeted and classified and subjugated and persecuted by their immutable characteristics, like religion, like their ethnicity. As you mentioned, the Uyghur people are an ethnic minority. And in addition to hearing about these stories of being taken away, their mosques are being razed. They're not allowed to pray in public. They're getting sent to these concentration camps for doing something seemingly innocuous, like wearing a hijab or having a beard that's visible. And this isn't something that is happening to the Chinese population as a whole, but to a specific people and their efforts to not only erase their culture, but to dehumanize them in the eyes of the public. And so a number of those things, if we wanted to look through the 8 stages or now 10 stages of genocide, all of those have been perpetuated by the Chinese people, by the CCP against the Uyghurs.
Right. So, I mean, one of the components of the UN definition of genocide is the preventions of birth, right? So the population is not going to be able to continue or through either sterilization, forced sterilization, which we know is happening to the Uyghurs, as well as sanctioning of rape by the majority ethnic group, which we also know is happening. Yet yet rape is still not defined as a weapon of genocide. But the whole point of what we're seeing there with the state sanctioning of rape is to slowly weed out the Uyghur minority, the Uyghur ethnic group, and replacing it with the majority Han ethnic group. So Serena, would you like to comment any more upon that aspect?
I mean, I can say we've heard firsthand stories. On Hanukkah, we helped organize a candle lighting in front of the Chinese embassy, and a Uyghur man came and told us that after his wife had their third child, that the CCP showed up at their house and told her she had to go to the doctor and had to have a hysterectomy. So we are hearing these stories and stories of if women aren't willing to marry Han Chinese men, that they can't have children. And yet the Han Chinese are able to, again, dehumanize these women and impregnate them to perpetuate the Han race.
Thank you, Serena. Thank you for providing your expertise in this area. Rehan, not only are you a lawyer and an activist, but you are Uyghur. And this particular issue is deeply personal. If you could please share with us your story and the story of your brother.
Yeah. Thank you for giving me the honor and privilege to be with you on Holocaust Remembrance Day. I ask this question, why do we go to the trouble of remembering the Holocaust, refusing to forget events that bring back so much trauma and pain? Because the cost of forgetting is even more painful. Because the Holocaust taught us that evil can happen at any time, anywhere, in the most civilized of societies, at the hands of the most technologically advanced nations, alongside the silence of the international community. We remember the Holocaust in all its grim, horrifying detail, because forgetting the image of genocide makes genocide more likely to happen again. We remember the Holocaust so that tomorrow's perpetrators do not feel emboldened, so that today's despots know that the world has not forgotten. If the worst evils humankind has committed is allowed to vanish into memory, have we truly progressed as species? Who will stand up for the Uyghur people to remind the Chinese government that never again means never again? I hope my own struggle can offer a lens to the genocide happening to my brother and my family. Akhbarasat is an amazing brother, friend, and son. Professionally, he's a Uyghur philanthropist and cutting-edge entrepreneur who became a household name among Uyghurs after establishing and successfully running a multifaceted media platform for our community in Western China. He was compassionate and committed to the vulnerable, helping children with disabilities and the elderly, and providing children access to education. He worked tirelessly to build bridges between all ethnic groups in the region and the government. Before the camps, the Xinjiang government itself extolled him as a bright star in the tech world and a positive force for humanity. Soon, his reputation landed him international recognition as a successful, innovative entrepreneur and peace builder. But in April 2016, my brother was forcibly disappeared within weeks of returning from the United States on a premier exchange program sponsored by the US Department of State. Unlike the Han members of his cohort who returned to their ordinary lives. I think about what my brother was doing on the day he was taken away. Could it have been just an ordinary day? What was I doing? Studying in the law library at Harvard? His forcible disappearance is an affront to the US democracy and values. He went through the same exchange program that has turned out world leaders like Tony Blair, Antonio Guterres, and Jacinda Ardern. He too should be leading his organization and entrepreneurial ventures with his message of peace and collaboration, but he was targeted by the Chinese government precisely because of his professional success, a leader in his own right, yet born into the wrong ethnicity, one that did not belong to a pure nation race subservient to Xi Jinping. Not a day has gone by that I've stopped missing him. Words fall short of describing the excruciating pain, agony, and damage caused by the Chinese government. Here at home in America, overlooking the Washington Monument thousands of miles away, I wonder what my brother's life is like. How could I eat good food and enjoy life? How did I even get by? How have days stretched into years? Not only did they take away the beautiful years we could have spent together, but also my memory of him. Sorry. On April 7th this year, we will be mourning the 5th anniversary of his solitary confinement. How many birthdays and holidays has Akbar spent in a dark cell alone, in despair, without hope of ever getting out? I cannot imagine how he counts seconds, minutes, hours, days, months, and years. Recently, the Chinese embassy in the US tweeted that in the process of eradicating extremism, the minds of Uyghur women in Xinjiang were emancipated, reproductive health was promoted, and the Uyghur women no longer baby-making machines. This was not surprising to me, given the Chinese government has long compared the Uyghur identity to mental disease. When hate becomes a state policy, it's a love that offers hope for the victims and their loved ones. Though I'm bleeding, deeply wounded, and outraged, though every cell in my body feels the unspeakable injustice and suffering my brother is facing every day, hate has never found a place in my heart. Because like survivors of the Holocaust, Akbar and his resilience teaches me that I must maintain my own humanity and compassion during this struggle. Despite everything I'm going through, I still try to be a good friend and ally to anyone during whatever they need me for. As we commemorate Holocaust Remembrance Day, I wish to honor the survivors and their families. In my moments of despair, I look to you for inspiration to keep up this fight, a fight of love and in service of humanity. When people deny the truth of what's happening to Akbar and my excruciating pain, I resort to your wisdom in responding to those complicit in committing an unchecked genocide. You are an international treasure, and the world is indebted to you for sharing your story and prevent mass atrocities. So thank you for being you. Ali Wiesel so wisely said, when human lives are endangered, when human dignity is in jeopardy, national borders and sensitivities become irrelevant. Wherever men and women are persecuted because of their race, religion, or political views, that place must, at that moment, become the center of the universe. His words must be heeded to recognize our shared humanity. Almost 5 years have gone by without any progress in closing the camps because of China's economic clout and indifference from world leaders and institutions. It's hard to process that millions of people are in the camps as we speak. And precisely because it's so hard to process, the Chinese government gets away with the crimes against humanity. At the time, nobody knew about Auschwitz. Who could have imagined such things? Looking at the bullet trains in Beijing, the skyscrapers, how could one simultaneously remember that a 4-hour flight away, there's a genocide taking place? My brother was vilified, erased, and shattered by the Chinese government officials, but he's been in the hearts of many. When victims are dehumanized, it's ever more important for us to honor them. I teamed up with a youth organization, Burst the Bubble UK, to put a face to Uyghur genocide and honor Akbar. These youths give me hope that better days are waiting for Akbar.
Thank you so much, Rehan.
Would you give me 1 second?
Yes, if you could please share the video.
Yes, I will. I try to share my screen. Sorry. Just give me 1 second. I think it's something going on with my Google Chrome. When we stand by, I just want to finish it off to say, when we stand by silently, we only contribute to suffering. So I ask you to join the moment of freeing Akbar. Because of his intellectual caliber, he seems to be in the worst of prison camps of all and in solitary confinement. We must save him. So please, I'm gonna ask all of you to help me, because you have the power to help me to spend the next few years helping my brother heal, helping him to restore memories of life before the prison camps, helping find what has been lost. We have another chance to do that right, and that time is now. Thank you.
Thank you, Rehan. Your story, your brother's story, is incredibly powerful and incredibly moving. And I am sure that your words have moved many on this call to take action. At the beginning of this panel, I stated that you, by being here, would all become a witness to this genocide by listening to Rehan, by learning about what is happening. You've become a witness. You're now a witness to this. And according to another quote from Elie Wiesel, and I honestly had no idea that his son was going to be on this call, but he was able to use words to really drive home memory and action. And he once stated, whoever listens to a witness becomes a witness. And that is what you all are now. You have listened to a witness, you have become witnesses. So how can you take what you have learned today and become an active witness? So Serena, what can those in the audience do to get involved, to make a difference, to advocate on behalf of this issue?
Sure. Well, there are several pieces of legislation that have, the US government has done, let's call it, a decent job at introducing legislation. And that's actually how Jewish World Watch initially got involved, right? We can't go into the region. We can't get scrutiny in the region. And so about 2 years ago, we began working with the Uyghur community and meeting with members of Congress, our supporters, and LA diaspora members to shine a light and to work to pass the Human Rights Policy Act or Human Rights Prevention Act. And what happened was the president actually signed it into law, and it mandated businesses to report where they were getting their labor from, and also said that it would mandate protections against harassment and extradition of Uyghurs. But we haven't seen it really enacted, or waiting for more legislation to that has teeth. And so we've been fighting to pass another bipartisan act called the Uyghur Forced Labor Act, which would presume that all goods produced in whole or in part in the Xinjiang region of China or East Turkestan are a product of Uyghur forced labor, and bans these goods from entry into U.S. port. It also imposes sanctions on the architects of the forced labor system. And it passed the House in September of 2020, almost unanimously. We thought actually, because of the bipartisan introduction, that it was gonna pass the Senate. In fact, we heard from some of our senators, they were gonna hotline it to the floor. And within days of hearing that news, instead, what we heard was multinational corporations going to the Hill and lobbying really hard and killing the bill. And so right now, what Jewish World Watch has done, in last November, we joined the coalition to end Uyghur forced labor, and subsequently led an effort to form an ad hoc coalition of Jewish organizations around the world, including Rene Kassan in the UK, the European Union of Jewish Students, the Jewish Movement for Uyghur Freedom, the JCRC, AJC in Detroit. And we're working to grow our numbers so that we can maximize our efforts and not act in a way that's disparate, but actually ensure that there's a Jewish value add and that our voice is amplifying the voices of Uyghurs through advocating in our respective countries, in engaging these, you know, you mentioned the significant number of businesses. There are at least 90 businesses, multinational corporations from Apple to Volkswagen, of course, you know, to a number of other car companies and cotton companies and Amazon and Costco. We could go through the list of just how embedded so much of our labor and our supply chains are a part of the Chinese economy. And until we are willing to stand up and say, this is unethical, we're not gonna stand for it, making sure our business leaders know and our legislators, not just here in the US, but around the country or around the world know that that something needs to be done, that action needs to take place, it's not going to end. And so, as I've said, these five initial organizations have gotten together. We're focusing on coordinated actions. And the first is a Uyghur week of action during the non-holy days of Pesach. We're going to have an interfaith Seder with members of the Jewish community and the Uyghur community. And I would invite everybody to be a part of it. I'm going to put a link in the chat for you to sign up and co-sponsor and join our Seder committee. And we're also doing a global day of advocacy where we, in the UK and many parts of Europe and Canada and here in the US, we lift up our voices as Jews to bear witness and to call ourselves to action and to call our legislators to take action. And then a third day, a global day of business engagement. So we're identifying, right now we're working with our own local California legislature to identify five businesses out of the 90 to figure out who might be at higher interest for scrutiny. So then we can work again, in coordination so that our legislators here in California and around the country can send letters to these business leaders and as well as rabbis and Jewish organizations saying their supply chains are unethical and we want to have a conversation and we want to find alternative uses of labor and hold them accountable.
I think you used the word coordinated and collaborated, and that's the key. If we are all able to come together and have a collaborative discussion about how we can coordinate our advocacy around this issue, we're going to maximize that impact. For anyone on this call that is interested in getting involved, we will be happy to share our contact information, and you can feel free to reach out to us and ask any questions or and say how you want to become involved. What we're going to do right now is backtrack just a little bit. And Rehan had a wonderful video that she wanted to share with us all. And we are having just a slight bit of technical difficulty, but I think we are going to be able to share that now. So, Tammy, if you're able to share that, that would be wonderful. Going to try and fix the volume.
I think maybe she's muted, that's why. Tammy, can you unmute yourself so that we can hear the music and the statements?
I'm so sorry, I didn't realize you guys didn't have sound.
Let's go back to the beginning.
There should be a box on the bottom left-hand corner that will say share volume when you hit share screen.
It should be a share computer sound when you begin to share screen.
Yes. So the joys of Zoom after however many months where we've been on it, we're still learning.
I know.
You probably have to unmute.
And kindest brother.
Is that working?
It's your birthday again.
Yes, Tammy.
And yet, you are in the Chinese government's prison camps, alone, scared, helpless, and perhaps even broken. I am so sorry it's taking this long, but I am fighting for your freedom every day. You are not forgotten, and I'm not alone in this fight.
People from all walks of life, friends, families, and individuals are united by your side.
There are many people around the world are fighting for you. Around the world.
From the United Kingdom, Australia, and you face the world alone, to Ethiopia, all across the globe, we are with ECPA, because the injustice facing ECPA is unimaginable, and he remains in our hearts. As the torchbearers of justice, we will carry ECPA through this struggle, because united we stand against oppression and hatred.
If you have a chance to hear it from somebody, a kind guard, please let this be a message of hope, love, and strength for you. We will fight for you. Do not give up. We will celebrate the next birthday together. I love you.
Say his name with us. We are going to free
Assad.
so glad we were able to get that video to work. It really just shows how global this this fight is. So thank you. So we have just a couple minutes left. If there are any questions that we have here in the chat, I think I saw a question that was, what are the non-Jewish organizations that are involved in this issue? Serena, are you able to answer that question?
Yeah, so there are a number of Uyghur organizations, including the Uyghur Human Rights Project, the Uyghur American Association. We partner with Uyghur LA, but the Uyghur Forced Labor, or the Coalition to End Uyghur Forced Labor, is there are 13 members of the steering committee, and then it's a like 25 to 30 additional organizations, including organizations that are part of the anti-genocide movement, but it's led by the Workers' Rights Consortium. The AFL-CIO is a member. And a number of different, Rene Kassan is also a member, Crane is also a member. And so is the JCRC AJC of Detroit, which is a Jewish organization. But there are a lot of, again, it's a lot of workers' rights organizations, but humanitarian organizations from around the world who really are recognizing that this is a moment that we have to come together, that we have to stand up, and that if we're not doing it in concert with one another, then we're not going to be able to have the kind of impact or move the needle in the way we want. And I just want to, I saw that there's also a Muslim, there was a question about Muslim groups, and there are a number of Muslim organizations, including CARE, but there's the Muslim Student Association, and a number of students at different universities who are also taking this on. So it's, it's a multi-faith, multi- organizational movement because we have to act.
Can I add something, Amber, to that? Because in my fight to free my brother, and obviously, you know, you naturally become the voice for the voices, and perhaps because my brother's story, because he was here and then he was detained into these camps like right after, it resonated with my fellow Harvard community. So from, you know, Harvard Republicans to Democrats, different political groups or faith groups or cultural affinity group or issue focus group, everybody came together. So, I mean, I think, you know, our natural instinct is to ask like, you know, so what about the Muslim groups? But I think this is where like we fall. You know, I really hope all of us, because we pledge never again, it doesn't matter. This is not a religious issue. This is not an issue that belongs to another affinity. This is a humanitarian issue. This is a human rights crisis. We're talking about genocide. So it doesn't matter. So I really hope like, you know, this is our chance to reclaim our shared humanity. And it would be hypocritical of me if I have only devoted my life just for this cause, and previously I didn't. You know, when the Syrian crisis happened, I was in Turkey and I also like was at the forefront. So I really hope all of us become human rights champion, and really, you know, and it, for us individually as Uyghur, it touches my heart so much when I see Jewish people start speaking out, because, you know, I think it really sends a strong message that, you know, we understand your pain. And just like I took inspiration from your stories, your resilience, to know that one day, perhaps Akbar and millions of Uyghurs can come out too and share their stories and make sure that we prevent future genocide from happening. So thank you.
Well, that is our time. I would like to once again thank our panelists, thanks Serena and Rehan for being here, and the JCPA for inviting us. This panel is just the first step in our collaborative engagement on this issue. So we look forward to working with each and every one of you. Thank you.
Thank you to Amber and Serena, and particularly Rehan. Your story is so moving, and I can only hope that you will be reunited with your brother sooner rather than later. And I'm now pleased to call on Leslie Dannon Rosenthal, who will introduce herself, sharing some of what she's been doing with JCPA regarding racial justice, and will present two additional speakers for our session today. Leslie.
Thank you, David. As David said, I am Leslie Dannon Rosenthal. I am from Greater Metro West, New Jersey. I'm also a board member of JCPA and the co-chair, along with Lois Frank, of JCPA's Task Force on Strengthening Jewish Communal Engagement with Black Communities. We're a 20-person committee made up of the different stakeholders within the JCPA network. This committee is working to ensure that JCPA continues as a leader and that the network as a whole is prepared to lead, engage, and have the tools needed to engage as formidable partners in this next phase of the civil rights movement we saw launch this summer. We will be preparing resources for the field, reaffirming the JCPA's resolve, strengthening relationships with Black leaders, and creating an important new role for Jews of color within the JCPA network and as leaders within this important work on racial justice, both at the national and local levels. We're pleased to have two wonderful speakers with us today, both of whom are close JCPA partners. The aim of this session is for us to hear from them about their own organizational priorities for the 117th Congressional Session. These priorities represent a pathway to help end racial disparities in our country and to eliminate systemic racism. While JCPA already works closely with these organizations, we believe that it is important to take the next steps towards aligning our policy priorities. JCPA already has strong policy on many of the issues we will hear about, which will be a place to start from as we plan out a racial justice platform to help guide all of our work in the civil rights space. After we hear from our speakers, we will move into breakout groups to discuss this further. I'd first like to introduce Hillary Shelton, the director of the NAACP's Washington Bureau and its senior vice president for advocacy and policy. Mr. Shelton will be followed by Sakira Cook, the director of the Justice Reform Program at the Leadership Conference on Civil and Human Rights and the Leadership Conference Education Fund. The Leadership Conference is a coalition charged by its diverse membership of more than 200 national organizations to protect and promote the civil and human rights of all persons in the United States. Hillary, the NAACP is one of the founding civil rights organizations in our country. Can you please share with us your priorities for achieving racial justice in America and where you believe the Jewish community can be a strong partner?
Now, thank you, Leslie. I'm just deeply honored to be here. And I'm appreciative that you're putting me before Sakira because I would not stand a chance coming after her. So the opportunity to come along those lines. She's a dear friend, and you know, the Leadership Conference is actually an organization of about 215 civil rights organizations that many belong to. As a matter of fact, it's grown over the years. What's also fascinating about the conversation that we're having right now is the Leadership Conference is actually a coalition that was formed by the NAACP as a civil rights organization, the Jewish community organization where Arne Aronson and his involvement along those lines at that time as well. And then certainly A. Philip Randolph, who was the president of the Pullman Porters Union at the time, bringing the union movement together along those lines. So it's an amazing thing that we've grown as we have to be the coalition that we are today as we work on issues along these lines. And I'm just delighted that JCPA is doing what it's doing, actually work with us in coalition partnership, if we might, not only here in Washington, but also throughout the country. You know, we have about 2,200 membership units at the NAACP. And when every state in the United States, but we're all still on military bases in places like Italy, Korea, Japan, and France. So in essence, we're an organization that focuses on very many of the issues in all those places, and of course, right here at home. As we're thinking about our issues are as prevalent as the concerns that American people deal with every day, whether it's criminal justice issues, as we're thinking about things like the Law Enforcement Trust and Integrity Act to address issues of police violence and misconduct, the misuse of force, and the like, retraining police officers to be able to do their job. Some people ask us a question, are we calling for a defunding of police? We're calling for a reorganization of our police departments as we look at how the power dynamic is so problematically off. Many of you have seen in outrage as some representative of some police departments trying to explain why one of their police officers killed someone who was unarmed, someone who in many cases was nothing but a teenager, but said somehow they felt threatened along those lines. And there's a long list of people we can talk to as we think about those examples. But it's amazing as we find that that representative of the police department steps forward to the TV cameras and otherwise and says how much they are saddened for the loss of life, but that their police officer did nothing wrong. That even as a Michael Brown would find himself walking from the equivalent of a 7-Eleven with nothing but some soft drinks and candy, but be shot to death by a 6'4" tall police officer. Officer Wilson was quite tall, but explained that somehow or another there was a good reason for him to feel that way, and that this 18-year-old that was already registered to begin college the very next week was some kind of a threat to a 6'4" tall man carrying a shotgun, a police automatic weapon in his holster, as well as a taser that he decided not to even bother pulling out in the first place. So those issues make us speak to the issue of the George Floyd bill. And if you saw George Floyd being summarily executed on television as the police officer placed his knee into his neck and stayed there leaning as some tapped him on the shoulder and said, "Are you sure this isn't too much?" And he just looked at him and continued to do it until, of course, Mr. Floyd was dead. So to think about those issues, we know that we need to fix that problem in a number of ways. We want a stronger police department, believe it or not. Stronger means more effective. Stronger means better trained. Stronger means better policy and better regulations. It means better oversight. And quite frankly, a stronger means higher levels of accountability. Because our police departments are as divided, even more so than our states are, and we do live in a federalist society, that indeed there are as many different interpretations of use of force as there are police departments, and as many different interpretations of those policies as there are police officers. And sadly and unfortunately, many, many Americans of all races and ethnicities, but disproportionately, racial and ethnic minorities and African Americans very particularly, find ourselves at an awful position of needing good law enforcement in our neighborhoods and communities, but finding that too often, the price is we have to very much give away even our civil and human rights, and too often, for no good reason, lives as well. So the Floyd bill is in preparation of reintroduction. We're excited about it. We were able to pass it through the House of Representatives in the 116th Congress. It's going to be pending before the 117th Congress. We're making tweaks along the way to make sure we can address those concerns. And again, so we have good, strong, effective police departments that have the trust and integrity necessary for them to be successful. And so think about those issues within that context is something called racial profiling. That is, racial profiling is when police officer decides that by virtue of the color of one's skin, they've probably committed a crime. Not that an APB has been called out for anyone that fits that necessary description, but very well they believe that if someone is one race and walking through a neighborhood that is predominantly some other race, that they should be utilizing their power and authority to enforce segregation. And in essence, will stop many, many African Americans walking through neighborhoods again. Not that they were doing anything wrong or that a call was made that someone had broken into someone's house, but indeed just decided that that person looks suspicious, and suspicious in a very racially tainted way. So racial profiling is part of the bill. Use of force is part of the bill. Screening is part of the bill. We believe that police officers need to be better screened. We had the very awkward experience on Capitol Hill, folks. The awkward experience as people were on Capitol Hill to find that many among those there were not only armed, but many that were members of extremist organizations and extremist groups. We want to make sure police officers don't bring that kind of discriminatory perspective to their job. We need that effectiveness. And I've talked to every single attorney general of the United States going back to Janet Reno, when my hair was still black, guys. In that conversation with Janet Reno, she made it very clear that racial profiling had to be addressed. That if police officers practice racial profiling, they won't be trusted. If they are not trusted, then they are unable to be successful in collecting information that will help prevent a crime from happening. Nor will the people living in the same communities that may look the same way, same racial skin color and otherwise, feel comfortable giving them the information they need to solve crimes as well. We need effective policing. And that means we trust and integrity in that process. We believe this bill will help very much. We also believe that within that context, giving more to people, not the officials, the authorities, but the people that are paying the taxes, that are living in the neighborhoods, to help provide oversight, assessment of what the police officer's behavior is and when they're doing it wrong and what the best process is for them to be effective, is something that very well needs to be done. So again, the George Floyd bill is very, very important to us to move along those lines. The NAACP is also deeply concerned about gun violence. We know that of all the children that are killed with guns in the United States of America, though African-American children are only 12.5% of the population, we're over 40% of the victims of gun-related homicides within from birth to 18 years of age. That's gotta stop. In essence, we know, and we all will agree, as much as we protect the right of one to own a gun if they'd like to, that there's somebody that you know, whether we say it out loud or not, that we prefer didn't have a gun in the first place. And so the kind of screening that needs to take place along those lines is crucial. We were able to pass in the 90s. 93, 94, we passed the Brady handgun bill and the assault weapons ban, and we're still trying to figure out what use is there for an assault weapon for folks living in an inner city neighborhood? What use is there for an assault weapon? When we talk to hunters, they'll tell you they're not very efficient. In other words, an assault weapon was actually created for the purposes of being able to spray lots of people in one swoop. It doesn't have to be accurate. It just has to continue to shoot fast enough so eventually as they continue to wave that gun back and forth, everyone gets shot. But we also know, for those serious hunters, if you have somebody using an assault weapon, if it's for food, there's not going to be very much meat left. In other words, big mistakes are made, lives are lost, and the cost is one that we all carry, not just in terms of intimidation, not just in terms of fear, but also in terms of the overall financial cost. We lost more hospitals in the 1990s that led up to President Clinton making that decision, because they had to fold because folks did not have insurance. In other words, when you go into a hospital through the most the most expensive door that there is, which is the emergency room, that it's going to cost a lot of money. And very well, what we experience is that about 85% of those going into our hospitals on that weekend, that Friday and Saturday night, had no insurance. And as such, their care had to be absorbed somewhere. I live in the nation's capital. Our general hospital is closed, no longer exists, as a matter of fact, because Friday and Saturday nights were some of the hottest, most violent nights that would occur. And we all ended up paying that bill. The hospital is closed. They couldn't afford to keep it open as a general hospital. So as we move from that, we know that guns are important. We appreciate how it's mentioned in the Constitution, but the Constitution does not say everybody should have one. As a matter of fact, when the Constitution was written, very few people had them, and the kind of guns they had would not have created the kind of challenge, the kind of danger that we're experiencing now living in our communities across the country. We want to address the death penalty. That is, the NAACP strongly opposed it because we've learned some tough lessons over the years. We use a term that we call lynching sometimes, and someone said, how can you compare lynching to the use of the death penalty in the United States? Well, let me tell you how. What we've learned is the mistakes that are made with the death penalty are much more often to be made against someone who is of color. The Death Penalty Information Center, a very active organization here in Washington, does extraordinary research along these lines about the use, effectiveness, and ineffectiveness of the death penalty, pointed out that of all the Americans that were sentenced to death, later freed because they were found to be innocent, African-Americans, though 12.5% of that population, were 35%. It also found there was even more outrageous. And let me say this before I move to this next point. When we talk about those that were freed, the average amount of time if they found it took to realize that they'd made a mistake, that more people make eyewitness mistakes against somebody who is a different race than they are. I'm talking about what our psychologists and psychiatrists tell us now, make more mistakes there than of someone who is part of the same racial group that they are a member of. So in essence, as we went through the criminal justice system, what we found is that 38% of those that were sentenced to death executed and then later found to be innocent were also African-Americans, again, that are only 12.5% of that population. There's no good use for it. It costs too much. It sends the wrong messages. For someone to say that somehow the death penalty is going to teach someone that killing someone is a great idea, to teach someone that killing someone is wrong, we believe it's absolutely outrageous. And we look at the actual financial cost, we know it's even worse than that. If we compare the two, we know that all those people were executed with a number of the precautions in place. We spent about $2.4 million on each execution. For those who are put in prison, even for the duration of their life, is about $750,000. There is no benefit to the use of the death penalty. And I haven't begun talking about the moral conviction and issues along those lines, religious perspectives and otherwise. The death penalty is something that we want to get rid of. We also want to make sure, and we're convinced we'll be able to do this one very well. The Violence Against Women Act is something that we began working with years and years ago. As a matter of fact, when Joe Biden was Vice President of the United States the first time around, we celebrated the 20th anniversary of the Violence Against Women Act, which is a bill that he championed for us all. In essence, as we move ahead, we're convinced we're going to be able to strengthen that particular provision even more now than ever. It's the dirty little secret what happens to American women in our society that we have to continue to fight and deal with. So in essence, making sure we have a fully funded Violence Against Women Act is extremely important to us as well. Shifting to just a couple other issues, I don't know if my friend Sakir has made it on yet. If she hasn't, I'll just say a few things until she does. Economic issues are also extremely important to us. As we think about economic fairness, as the saying goes, civil rights is crucial. It is key, it is fundamental. But civil rights is an issue that we have to talk about fairness and justice around as well. So to thinking about jobs and the fact that even in the one brief conversation I had face-to-face with Mr. Trump, he seemed to think that he'd done everything to settle the unemployment issue in the country because it was better than it had ever been before. Sometimes inheritance can be a great thing if you're inheriting the agenda of a Barack Obama. Let me put that in those terms as well. So that was very helpful to him. But let me also say he didn't realize that the disparities were still there. As we look at lowest ever, the disparate impact is African Americans are disproportionately going to be unemployed. We're going to find out that we're paid less money for doing the same job. We're going to find out that a living wage isn't even an issue that's discussed very often. You're also going to find out that we're not alone, that women are disproportionately underpaid, that Latin Americans are disproportionately underpaid, and other Americans as well. We have to make sure we take that fight on. And that's why we want to see first the minimum wage increase, then we want to see it tied to the cost of living index. It becomes a political hot potato. Every time it comes up, we find that we're so far below the rate that of all those who are living in our country and being paid minimum wage. A family of three in which one person works 40 hours a week for the entire year still comes out $3,000 below the poverty line. We got to raise the minimum wage. We got to make sure that people are paid something more akin to a living wage so they can take care of their families and pay for what's on the table and not have to work four jobs and try to figure out how to take care of young children and issues along those lines. Let me also say, just as I give you kind of the last two, we've got to address our issue of voting rights and election reform in the United States. We know that even as much as we had the largest turnout in the history of the country in this last election, we also know that we're still unraveling the problems, the disenfranchisement that occurred to too many Americans across the country. And that's why we want to fix that problem as well. We want to make sure that everyone has an opportunity to register. We want to actually expedite that process. We're one of the very few so-called industrialized nations in the United States of America that is not automatically registered to vote at the time we reach voting age. If we lived in France or Germany, if we live in Canada, for that matter, as Great Britain too, as soon as we were old enough to vote, we would automatically be able to go in and start voting. We've seen those ugly film footages of people like C.T. Vivian, bless his heart, just passed away last year, taking a group of ministers and rabbis and others to the registration office so that they could vote. Of course, they decided to close the office during that time. And as he explained that they were there to register to vote because they believed in the promise of America, he was beaten to the ground. with a nightstick by the sheriff. And if you get it, if you want to, you can see just how bad it was for him, but he continued to push to stand up even as those blows hit his head. He knew that he was gonna have to make it clear why things were working the way they did. So we wanna make sure that we address issues of automatic voter registration. We wanna make sure that we take on issues of making sure that everyone that registered to vote, their votes are not thrown out as we've seen too often for various reasons. We wanna make sure that as we work to see the very core of our country, the very core of our democracy is really in our right to cast that unfettered vote and make sure that vote is counted. Another very, very important issue to us. I want to say this as I close, as I see my friend Sakir on the screen right now. Sakir, I'm so just glad I got to go before you. Let me say, as we're having these conversations, fight, that we can win these battles, and that you guys are smart enough to recognize why we're having this conversation. You guys are from cities and states all over the country, and as much as we gather together to have that fight focused on Capitol Hill, the White House, and the various government agencies, whether it's legislation or regulation, we know that fight also has to happen at the state level. So making sure that we can come together in this federalist society and see to it that these particular pieces are put together at the ground, the policies of policing, the policies of economics, the policies of education, and so much more, are fights we're going to have at both places. So I can't think of better partners than you guys. We'll have a good time doing it, but we will fight until the fight is over, and we'll continue to fight to keep what we get. So I appreciate it very much, Leslie and David, for the opportunity to join everyone. And I'm just honored to have the opportunity to listen to my friend Sakir Cook explain the rest of what we're going to do on Capitol Hill as we go through the 117th Congress.
Hillary, thank you so much. Those are some inspiring challenges you've laid before us. And now we're so happy to have Sakira with us. Sakira, JCPA is a co-founder and an active member in the Leadership Conference on Civil and Human Rights. And we've worked closely with your organization on our criminal justice reform portfolio. As a representative of the Leadership Conference, a premier civil rights organization, what does this time period mean to you, and what do you see as today's priorities?
Well, first, I want to say hello to everyone. Hi, Hillary. Thank you for those kind words. And thank you, Leslie, to JCPA for inviting me to come speak with you all today, and also for the partnership that we've had over many, many, many years that I've been at the Leadership Conference in working to push for transformative change within the criminal legal system. And so, you know, my work, my role at the organization is to lead our program, our justice program, and also coordinate the advocacy efforts of our vast coalition around our justice priorities. You know, Hillary went over many of those. He's a hard act to follow, but I will do my best. But I will say that, you know, over the last year, racial and economic oppression has been further amplified through the many tragic incidences of not only police violence, but COVID, as Hillary mentioned, but also, you know, the recent acts of sedition and attempted coup and insurrection that we saw several weeks ago on Capitol Hill. And for us, this new administration and new Congress has an opportunity to step into the power that that everyday Americans sort of gave them when they went to the polls and they voted in droves to vote out, you know, a white supremacist president, and vote in change and vote in a better future for everyone. And so it's in our view, it's our role to sort of keep everyone honest, to keep these leaders accountable to the citizens, to the organizers, to the communities that have lifted them up, that lifted them up and put them in place in November, and to urge them to, you know, move with post haste in this Congress. Because I would say, you know, we all know after the first 2 years, the campaign starts again and people are less likely to move on, unfortunately, issues of civil and human rights and issues that are often seen as quote unquote, not bipartisan or wedge issues. So we have to use every bit of the next 18 months to urge Congress, to urge this administration to build a new non-carceral paradigm for public safety, one that will truly keep all communities safe, and that looks at how we invest our precious resources, not only at the federal level, but also at the state and local level, and move those resources away from investments that we have done over time into the criminal legal apparatus, but into social supports that Hillary was talking about, into economic opportunity, into infrastructure, into health, into other social services that we know, education, housing, that we know keep communities thriving, that keep everyone safe and able to live the lives that our Constitution says that we all should be able to live. So for us, this agenda is a bold agenda. I don't know if everyone has seen, and we can share a copy of it, but each of our task forces at the leadership conference, we have 11 task forces on various issues. I lead the justice task force, but we also have a voting rights task force, an employment task force, a media and tech task force, a healthcare task force, education, immigration, housing, and I probably am missing something. That's what happens when you start to name things. Oh, census as well. And each of those task forces has set out an agenda, not only for the administration, so a list of administrative priorities, but also a list of legislative priorities that we would like to see movement on in the 117th Congress. Hillary touched on quite a few of the most pressing, I would say, task force priorities, issues, I would say, across our task forces. But I'll highlight a few in the justice space that I'm not sure if Hillary mentioned, but I'll mention, they bear mentioning again, if he hasn't. Marijuana justice is a huge issue for us. Hillary talked a lot about the disproportionate impact that the criminal legal system and our criminal laws have on people of color. And that is true, that is no truer in the context of drug offenses, where African-Americans, especially as it relates to marijuana offenses, have been disproportionately arrested and incarcerated for those offenses and for a plant that we now are seeing, for lack of a better word, white business owners be able to thrive in this market, in this new market where we're saying it's okay for medical marijuana, or even it's okay to legalize the plant. And so it's now time for the federal government to remove its restrictions, to decriminalize marijuana at the federal level and provide a pathway for resentencing for those who are currently incarcerated, and to incentivize those at the state and local level to do the same, to allow for a pathway for that. Another issue that I wanna flag is pretrial justice. You all have heard a lot about bail, money bail, and the impact that money bail has not only on people who are impoverished and living well below the poverty line, or even those who are living at the poverty line or slightly above, but in the impact that has on people. But it's not just about ending money bail. It's also about transforming our pretrial justice system and pushing for procedural reforms that will ensure that no one is detained prior to trial without clear and convincing evidence that they are a known threat to an individual person. Right, not this sort of broad blanket public safety concept that people use as a mechanism for trying to detain Black and Brown people, but really that we know that this person is a serious threat. And we also know that the statistics bear out that the majority of people who are held pretrial are there for very low level offenses, right? Are there for misdemeanors, and they can be moved easily out of the system without even having to have a hearing on the merits of whether or not they should be detained. But for those that do need to have a hearing, that should be a robust adversarial process and not something that's determined within 30 seconds, because in most jurisdictions, that's what happens. Bail decisions are made within 30 seconds to a minute, and people are cycled in and cycled out and lose jobs, lose family connections, lose homes, lose children because of their pretrial incarceration. And the last couple of things that I'll mention, I think Hillary mentioned voting rights, of course, which is the John Lewis Voting Rights Act, but also the right to restore, or the need to restore voting rights to people who were formerly in prison. We have a very robust that you should never lose your right to vote. Voting is the language of our democracy. If you don't vote, you don't count. And eliminating a person's access to the ballot box in our view, you know, sort of limits their full enjoyment of their human rights and their civil rights. And so no one should ever lose the right to vote. But at a minimum, we need to restore those rights to people who are, you know, currently incarcerated or people who have had felony convictions at the federal level. So the Democracy Restoration Act is a piece of legislation that is a priority for our organization. And then lastly, looking at fair chance licensing. Over the last several years, we've made a huge inroads in removing barriers to employment for people with records. And those barriers are often, you know, questions on applications or even background checks that are done, but there isn't an individualized assessment of whether or not that person's background makes them ineligible for the position, in violation, in our opinion, of Title VII. And the EEOC made inroads in giving employers guidelines for how they can evaluate someone with a criminal history. The next step, and we've made, you know, progress, we've passed the Fair Chance Act, which was championed by the late Representative Cummings. And that was passed in as part of, I would say, the NDAA in the last Congress. But we need to go a step further. Licensing is a huge issue for people with records. People often get all types of licensing in prison, whether it's cosmetology licenses or truck driving licenses. It runs the gamut, right? And what happens is, while they have these qualifications and certifications in prison, when they come out, they might go home to a state that has barriers to being able to work in those fields because of their background. So you do all this education in prison, you're supposed to come out and regain and reenter society and become a productive member, but then you can't do that because you can't find a job, right? And it sort of starts this cycle of reincarceration and recidivism that we want to stop. So there's a piece of federal legislation that we're working on with Senator Booker that we hope to be reintroduced this Congress to address that issue. And then the issue of hate and bias that is, you know, top of mind, I think. And I'm sure we all have heard of a push to add a charge, a domestic terrorism charge to the federal code. And the leadership conference, amongst many other organizations in our coalition, have taken a position that we are opposed to a new domestic terrorism charge. And there are reasons for that, right? We know that certain communities in this country have often borne the brunt of the tagline domestic terrorists. Those are Arab American, Masa groups, as well as Black organizers. If you go back to the days of COINTELPRO, I mean, just looking at the Black Panther Party and others, you know the history, right? You know how this all plays out in our country. And so we are very concerned that the use of that terminology, not only, but also the implementation of a new charge would disproportionately harm those communities. And so for us, the way we address hate and bias, and you all know this well, right? You work on these issues and you have for years, is really not necessarily about prosecution, although that's one tool. But we actually have to reshape how we think about race in America. And we've never had a reckoning in this country with respect to truth telling and reconciliation, or, you know, sort of reformation or restorative justice. And that is the some of the ways in which we can approach these issues moving forward. And also reparations. Reparatory justice is a key issue that we have been pushing for. And the legacies of enslavement that continue to plague our democracy and all of the issues that Hillary and I have talked about are still present and prevalent in today's society, and we absolutely have to confront those for once and for all and undo the harm that they have done for centuries, for decades, for hundreds of years. So those issues are those are the sort of issues, the racial justice issues, not all of them, as I said, but I was giving you some top lines of the things that are present of mind and also the things that we know Congress is going to be paying attention to. Well, last thing I'll note for the domestic terrorism piece, this is an intersectional issue with the criminal legal system. You know, as we add new criminal penalties to the code, the likelihood that more and more Black and Brown people are funneled into the criminal legal system happens, right? And currently today, I just want people to know this, because this is a little known fact. there are 50, over 50 statutes currently today that can be used to prosecute people, those individuals who attempted a coup and an insurrection and sedition on Capitol Hill. And in fact, many of the charges are not aligned with those statutes. people have been charged with things like disturbing the peace, you know, misdemeanor, you know what I mean? So while they were engaged in terrorist activities, they are not being charged, even under current law, with the many statutes that would qualify based on the crimes that they committed, qualify them to be charged under. And so we don't need to add a new statute. We just need to use the tools that we already have. And then we need to change and think critically about how we, through law and policy, start to change the narrative around race relations in this country, around telling the true story of race relations in this country, and having, again, like I said, a true reckoning of our history of enslavement and how it has continued to permeate through all of the issues. We've seen it in COVID, we've seen it in the criminal legal system, we see it in voting and access to voting and many, many other issues. So I will stop there and turn it back over to you, Leslie, and happy to answer any questions that you all may have.
So first of all, thank you both so much. I mean, these are issues that I think so many of us are seeing in our work in individual communities, at the state level, and at the national level. I'm keeping my eye on the time, and we really do want to have time to talk in our small breakout groups, although I am seeing questions come in. These are questions that we're going to continue to work on. I'm really proud of the work that our task force has done, and we look forward so much to working closely with the NAACP, with the Leadership Conference, as we enter the next phase of this work together. And really, these are the most important issues we can be facing internally, I think, within the United States, as much as we also have to look outward and face situations like with the Uyghurs in China. So with that, I want to again just thank you so much. You've raised so many important issues, and let us talk in our small groups about how these issues are playing out in our own communities. So it's now my pleasure to call on Susan Abravanel, JCPA's Policy Advisory Committee co-chair, who will give us our marching orders.
Thanks so much, Leslie. So we've just heard from two very significant partners working on racial justice. And they've outlined the policy priorities that they believe will help this country achieve racial justice. And JCPA too, as you know, has committed to this work. So we're now going to move into the interactive portion of our meeting, a short interactive portion. In a moment, you are going to be placed into breakout groups. To assist with our conversations, we put together a background document that presents top line overviews of our existing policies on several of the issues. This platform will serve as a show of our solidarity and support on key issues of importance to our partners, and as a menu of options for local JCRCs working on justice and equity in issues in their own coalitions. It's important to note that while we may not need to create new policy because we already have a lot of existing policy, we will be prioritizing our advocacy efforts on these concerns. We're now going to have 15 minutes in our breakout groups. You're going to be broken out into groups. In each room, we have a pre-assigned moderator who will first ask for a note taker before beginning the session. So we will be able to capture the conversations that are held in each room. The goal of your conversation will be to address the following two questions, which we are hoping to put at the top of the screen once you're in your breakout group. First, how can we align our work, the work of JCPA, the work of your JCRC, locally and nationally to partner on achieving these goals? And secondly, as a diverse Jewish community, how can we strengthen our relationships with Black communities? So once you are in your room, you'll be able to see these questions, hopefully, and your room moderator will repeat them for you. At the end of the time, we're going to reconvene as a group of the whole and ask your note takers to report on your conversations on some of them. And just a reminder, we're going to ask all note takers to please send us their notes so that we can capture everyone's responses. Okay.
Hi, everybody.
Harold, I had told you about this meeting.
Welcome back, everyone. I hope you all had fruitful discussions. I am Corey Shapiro. I am a JCPA board member, co-chair of the Policy Advisory Committee, and a member of the Louisville JCRC. I thought our conversation was very fruitful. It was fun, and it was great to hear from so many different people. And now we'd like to hear from all of you. And so I'd like for us to go around and for each of the note takers from each of the breakout rooms to spend about 1 minute. We don't have too much time, but we do want to hear from everyone. 1 minute or less explaining to us some of the highlights from your conversation. Please remember to send the full notes to JCPA. We really want to review them all. We will put the email to which those notes should be sent in the chat. It will be hluftig@thejcpa.org to Haya. These reports will be shared with our entire Policy Advisory Committee and the Task Force on Black Communities. And we really are looking forward to getting all of your input. So with that, can breakout, whoever was the note taker for breakout group number one, if that person can go ahead and unmute themselves and start speaking, that would be great.
I believe that was actually my group. Laura, if you could go ahead.
Sure. Our group, we talked about a few things. One thing that kept coming up was it would be helpful for our community from JCPA to get some language and framing as to why different issues related to community relations are a Jewish issue and why it's important for our community to invest in the issues that JCPA is raising to convince our communities and organizations about why it's important. We also talked about relying on our regional partnership when it comes to advocacy and how potentially connecting the local and national partnership in this sense, it could be helpful to lean on regional relationships and kind of tailoring messaging in that way. We also talked about how election reform is important when we're discussing voter rights. Racial equity task forces are helpful with JCPA and also locally. If anyone else wants to chime in, they're welcome from our group, but I think that was
That's great, Laura. Thank you so much. I think you summed it up very nicely.
David, do you want to go next? I'm just going to go down the list. Actually,
okay,
Nancy.
Okay. I wasn't sure if we were grouped David Bernstein, right? There's a couple of Davids. I wasn't sure if we were next, but Sabrina took notes for our group. We had a great discussion.
Thank you, everyone. So we did a lot. We just talked about also about relying on our national organizations who have already built these relationships and are sitting at the table with organizations that we may not be able to have access to at our local level. Again, if the national levers would provide policies and approaches for us, that's helpful. We also talked about the need to really educate on the local level, especially for some of the smaller communities that maybe some of these issues really aren't at the forefront, but an opportunity to educate the community about the things that are going on and why these issues exist and what's going on with them. We also talked about finding out what our local officials are supporting so that we can get on board with them and find out the causes that are important to them. So reaching out to them and seeing what bills they'll be working on this year. And David did point out also the importance of the listening tour and just talking to people to find out what they support.
Thanks, Sabrina.
Sums us
up. Great, thank you, Sabrina and David. Let's go now to David Bohm.
Hi,
Hi, I'm Rachel. I'm from Portland, Oregon. So we ended up with a lot of us from Portland in our group. Half our group was made up of Portland locals. So we talked a little bit about what we were doing here in Portland, both legislatively and through our intergroup outreach, reestablishing and making new connections with the NAACP, mostly programmatically around educating our community on racism and anti-Semitism. But also looking at the systemic things that need to happen, which came out during the summer with police reform and an interfaith group that we're a part of with there. We talked a little bit about how defunding the police is a misnomer, and we need a more constructive way of looking at it, that JCPA doesn't use this term, defunding police, but there's policy on reforming and refunding. But really what we think is important right now is the Voting Rights Act and voting rights reform. And how we need to revisit the voting acts right and look at what's been stripped away and restoring what has been lost. So those were the main points.
Great, thank you, Rachel. Susan was the moderator. Who was the note taker for her group?
Judy Lakritz. Judy? I think she's...
Hi. We had an interesting discussion about what's going on in each of our communities. They were quite interesting. Every community is working. In New Haven, they're working on getting people with records into getting jobs. That's an interfaith effort. In Denver, Colorado, they're working on local racial issues to address them. Greater Philadelphia, they endorsed the John Lewis Voting Act and supporting racial justice bills. Avi in Nashville said relationship building through sitting on boards, and they're trying to re-engage Black-Jewish relations. Diana Sirkin talked about writing resolutions on racial justice and how they're coming into difficulty with what words to use. Stephen Stone in Springfield said they're working on reintegration of previously incarcerated into the community. I'm from San Antonio. We're trying to navigate a recent rupture between our police chief and our fixed San Antonio Police Department. I think we could all benefit by being able to have more interchange with each other and JCPA.
Great, thank you, Judy. Leslie Anderson, who was the note taker for your group?
Hey, I guess I was. We only had five people. A couple of people dropped out. So we just started talking and I just took notes. Unless Diane, you wanted to jump in.
Basically, I could also say something as well.
That would Leslie. Be great.
Yeah, go ahead.
So basically all we had is we talked a little bit about the need for, the struggles with fragility and being able to talk about the issues of fragility, setting parameters for definitions as we go into this work, both internally and as we move into an external space. We also talked about the need for assistance either from each other across cities or from the net or JCPA on how to start these relationships where we don't already have those relationships in place, possibly through some interfaith networks. We also talked about, Lauren from Detroit shared about their use, and we use this a lot in Atlanta as well, the use of coalitions and how we can use that around different issues and also, best practices. And then last but not least, Diane had talked about Eric Ward and what a great resource he has been and how we might be able to use him more substantially, especially around the anti-Semitism and racism and how that's connected and how we might be able to utilize that more robustly across our work with JCPA. Bill, would you like to add anything?
Yeah, that's great. I just love the anti-Semitism is at the heart of racism is what he says. And I love that. And that there's an issue of the organized Black community in some of our cities is being difficult to get a handle on. And maybe being a little bit amorphous, hard to define. So that's another issue that's a little bit challenging, I know, in Seattle, and I think also in Silicon Valley. Thanks.
Great. Thanks, Bill and Leslie. Let's go to the other Leslie, her group. Who was the moderator or the note taker in your group, Leslie?
Harvey.
Harvey.
So just very briefly, we covered a fair number of topics. One was just the common sense notion that we ought to react to the priorities from JCPA through letter writing and contacting our legislators on issues, the national issues. That was one thing we talked about. We also talked about the importance in terms of coordinating our activities in alignment with JCPA priorities to listening to our partner groups. That would be a high priority, not trying to lead, but to listen. We also talked about having timeframes in mind and prioritizing issues, not trying to do too much at once. One of the people in our group also talked about scheduling regular meetings among leaders in the community and how important that was to effective group advocacy, to have routine meetings where they would converse about a whole range of issues and get to know each other better and do that regularly. We also talked about the importance of the rabbinate in advocating issues of importance to JCPA members and how we could rely not only on rabbis who have congregations, but those who are also in leadership positions outside of their own congregations, and that would be an important way of advancing some of the JCPA priorities. And we have one suggestion, just to be quotable. When you get a chance to talk about an issue, say something pithy that will get people's attention. And that's about it.
Great, thanks, Harvey. Eric, who was the note taker for your group?
It was Jane. Jane, do we still have you?
Here we go. We talked a lot about the importance of outreach into our community. We represented, except for Melanie, we represented, and Eric, we represented the whole West Coast, the gamut. And in Seattle, it seems that they're embarking on creating a consensus statement, creating a roadmap, and looking towards broader education within their community. So they're striking out on a really challenging year ahead. And we talked about the importance of reaching out both, for example, to the NAACP, Urban League, and so on, both on a from our professional staff as well as individually, on a in one-on-one relationships. And we need to really advocate locally on these, and to really develop these strong relationships. We have several synagogues in our area that have very strong social action committees, and they kind of are backups to our JCRC and our local JCRC in pursuing these relationships within these communities. So we kind of have a backup there, as well as in some other the nonprofits in our area. And we are also encouraged to work, to step in and be active, as well as developing these relationships, encourage them to step in and be active and show up at various meetings, civic meetings, civil engagements, as well as developing these one-on-one relationships so that we're part of the advocacy not just showing that we know that we have these one-on-one relationships. So that's about it from our committee. Does anyone else have something to add?
That was great, Jane. Thank you.
Thanks, Jane. If I could just ask everyone to stay on just a few minutes long so we can get through. We have about four more groups to get through. If people can just be flexible with their time and hear all the groups. The next group I have on my list is Faye's group. Okay, I don't know who the...
Howard Libet from Baltimore. I'll be really quick because I know a number of people have other things set. I just want to focus on one issue, which was we talked a lot about the importance of engaging with local groups, that what the national organizations may talk about at a national level for federal criminal justice reform may be very different than the issues our communities are facing in terms of local prosecutors, state laws. And so it's important for us to figure out as individual JCRCs, who's effective locally, who's engaged, and it may not be the local NAACP, it may be other groups, and we need to be aware of that. And also when we talk about educating our communities to get them to join our advocacy, you know, what does that look like? How do we facilitate the right kinds of local conversations about local criminal justice issues? And how can that talk then be applied to actual legislation? All the other points we talked about are in the notes I've already sent to Haya, but that's probably enough. Thank you.
Great, thanks, Howard. Marcy Paul's group, who's gonna speak from that group?
Marcy, is that me? This is Cookie. I'm not
thinking. Yep, that's you.
All right, I'm gonna be, hello, very, very quick because everybody's gotta go. One dominant theme was how do you build relationships? And we concluded from the ground up and the top down that you really need to start at both places to be effective, and in different circumstances, each one of those strategies will pay off in benefits. The other thing that was mentioned was very interesting was mapping collaborations and mapping assets of community. And I'm gonna send notes in. So in the interest of time and hearing everybody, that's it.
Great, thanks, Cookie. Marcy Gersten's group.
Hi, that was me, Eric Rosenblum from Silicon Valley JCRC. And I'm gonna try to follow that lead of being brief. Our group really focused on the challenge of diversity, both in terms of the communities in which we live and the Jewish communities. The example given from the nation's capital is that Washington, D.C. is really three communities. There's the capital, there's also Maryland and Virginia, where they may have many police issues that could be addressed by criminal justice reform. And it's a question of limited resources and staffing and which problems do you address. The example given from Philadelphia really put that into high relief by saying that there was an issue of anti-Semitism in one of the major Black community organizations. This despite the fact that within Philadelphia, 10 to 12% of the population of the Jewish community were Jews of color. So you can see the complexity that's revealed there. In Florida, the political views of the Jewish community are also very diverse. So finding a criminal justice position, as it was put, that doesn't inflame some members was difficult. And ultimately, the suggestion was that there's no easy way to start these conversations. So any way you do them is good. Education is key. And any step that you take may be bigger than you think.
Great, thanks, Eric. My group is next, and Susan from Silicon Valley was our note taker. So Susan, if you wanna go ahead now.
Susan, you're muted.
I think you're on mute.
One of the things that I haven't heard yet was from Detroit, they suggested that the JCPA create a clearinghouse where local JCRCs could reach out and put together, and maybe they could put together a toolkit of national priorities that would help JCRCs, the locals, to look at the national level and align some of their ideas with that. The other thing that came out that were a couple of challenges that I think people need to be aware of, and one in one area where they tried to work with several other organizations related to police violence. And in the end, what happened was that there were, I'm sorry, I'm gonna have to stop. I have a class that I'm teaching and they're waiting for me. I'll send my notes in for you. Thank you.
Thank you, Susan. That's okay. Sorry, I didn't see your note. The next group is Bruce's group.
That's Talia.
So our group really echoed Howard's and Cookie's points about using and capitalizing on the local and regional offices of our Jewish organizations and how they have their own special relationships with different groups. And then, you know, having our, that the top kind of shadow that and make use of these really special and, you know, different and diverse partnerships. And then on the flip side, you know, in this structure of using our bureaucratic structures of all of these Jewish organizations, I think it was Barb Weinstein at the RAC who said that JCPA is really well positioned and has been kind of positing themselves as a round table where all these organizations can come together. So, you know, Barb just said continuing to use JCPA as a round table where we can all share resources, share ideas, share these toolkits all of you are mentioning that we can all go forth and use. And that's it.
Thanks, Talia. And I think the last group is Nancy Kaufman's group.
Hi, last but not least, Lindsay's going to report for us.
Hey, everyone. Our group consisted of Brandon from Charleston, Wendy from Denver, Beth from Louisville, Lois from Atlanta, and me from Indianapolis. And Nancy led us beautifully, and lots of echoing of what we've heard already. I think there's a general consensus that all politics is local, all relationships need to emerge from a local level. And that when it comes to aligning with national, it would be helpful to think about which key voices on a national level we could all be tapping into, maybe template out some, you know, here are the things to think about on a local level. Do you have relationships with these groups? Have you looked into these issues, these types of organizations? And then sort of merge the two. But every community is focused on this in some way or another.
Great, thanks, Lindsay. And I think I got everyone's group. If somebody didn't, just speak up now and let me know. Otherwise, I wanted to thank all of you for attending today's Delegate Assembly. We want to make sure you have JCPA's National Virtual Conference on your calendar for April 25th to 26th, though. Before I leave, I want to make sure everyone has that, marks that as a save the date. We're going to be having our Delegates Voting Assembly session on the evening of April 26th. You'll be receiving the draft resolutions at the end of this week for vetting in your communities. Colleagues from around the community, from around the country have been hard at work preparing them and helping to shape our stances and priorities in the public square. So we appreciate you giving the time and having that discussion in your communities to this important work so we can have a fruitful debate and discussion and voting session on the 26th. The dates again are April 25th and 26th. And the Delegates Assembly session will be on the evening of April 26th, which is my mom's birthday.
And thank you, Corey. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you all for attending.